sit over there, so then you'll have to just go over there. It'll be a lot easier that way.
Good morning. Good morning. Welcome to St. Matthew's Lutheran Church. It's good to be in worship with you on this Holy Palm Sunday. We have a few announcements before we begin. Adult education this morning, which will happen in the upper room, is on the Muhlenbergs, the only American Lutheran dynasty, with David Zerzan. Come learn about the Muhlenberg family immediately after this service. Also, after this service, bag lunches are being prepared for the repairs of the breach in the downstairs kitchen. It's a quick service project that anyone of any age can do. You don't need special skills. You stand in the assembly line and put together lunches for those who need them. So please join. The Wednesday evening Bible study will continue this Wednesday and each Wednesday from 6 to 7 in the upper room. They are beginning studying the book of Jonah. This Wednesday and next Wednesday, there are snacks, so you should come. But our regular Wednesday Lent evening programming is not happening this Wednesday, but our Bible study is. And the reason we're not having a Wednesday Lent programming this week is because we have Monday, Thursday, Good Friday, and Easter Sunday. So put all of these dates and times on your calendar so you can experience the fullness of Holy Week. Monday, Thursday, the service will be at 7 p.m., followed by a healing service. There will also be Holy Communion. Good Friday at 10 a.m. is a children's service with an Easter egg hunt. Even the littlest kids can come to this. I'm sure they will enjoy it. The Good Friday evening service at 7 p.m. is a service from light into darkness. And on Sunday at 8:30 and 11, our regular worship times, we will be having our festive Easter celebration with Holy Communion and Easter breakfast in between those services in the fellowship hall. Please come for all of it. We do, however, need people to sign up to be volunteers to make all of those special services happen. Things that don't happen the rest of the year happen during Holy Week, so we need extra people to make them meaningful and beautiful. So if you can prepare communion, be an acolyte, an usher, a greeter, or a reader, please sign up at the Welcome Center. And we still need some eggs for that Easter egg hunt on the morning of Good Friday. You can take empty ones from outside of the office and return them filled by Wednesday. We need a lot of eggs. And we are so happy to announce that the installation of Pastor Kevin will take place on Sunday, April 14th, 2 weeks after Easter, at both the 8:30 and 11 a.m. worship services. The Bishop, Paul Erickson, will be here to preach and to help install Pastor Kevin as our new lead pastor. There'll be a reception in between services. It will be a lovely service. Please plan on attending. There are more announcements in your bulletin, but for now, let us open our hearts and minds and prepare for worship.
Thank you. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Mercifully assist us, O Lord God of our salvation, that we may enter with joy upon the contemplation of those mighty acts whereby you have given us life everlasting. Through your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen. When they were approaching Jerusalem at Bethphage and Bethany near the Mount of Olives, he sent two of his disciples and said to them, "Go into the village ahead of you, and immediately as you enter it, you will find tied there a colt that has never been ridden. Untie it and bring it. If anyone says to you, 'Why are you doing this?' just say, 'The Lord needs it and will send it back here immediately.'" They went away and found a colt tied near a door outside in the street. As they were untying it, some of the bystanders said to them, "What are you doing, untying the colt?" They told them what Jesus had said, and they allowed them to take it. Then they brought the colt to Jesus and threw their cloaks on it, and he sat on it. Many people spread their cloaks on the road, and others spread leafy branches that they had cut in the fields. Then those who went ahead and those who followed were shouting, "Hosanna! Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the coming kingdom of our ancestor David. Hosanna in the highest heaven." Then he entered Jerusalem and went into the temple. And when he had looked around at everything, as it was already late, he went out to Bethany with the 12. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
We praise and thank you, O God, for the great acts of love by which you have redeemed us through your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. On this day, he entered the holy city of Jerusalem in triumph, and was acclaimed Son of David and King of Kings by those who scattered their garments and branches of palms in his path. We ask that you bless those who bear these branches, and grant that we may ever hail him as our Lord and King, and follow him with perfect confidence, through the same Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Let us go forth in peace.
In the name of the Lord.
Thank you.
Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Let us pray. O God of mercy and might, in the mystery of the passion of your Son, you offer your infinite life to the world. Gather us around the cross of Christ and preserve us until the resurrection through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
The Passion of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to Mark. It was 2 days before the Passover and the festival of unleavened bread. The chief priests and the scribes were looking for a way to arrest Jesus by stealth and kill him. But they said,
"Not during the festival, or there may be a riot among the people."
While he was at Bethany in the house of Simon the leper, as he sat at the table, a woman came in with an alabaster jar of very costly ointment of nard. And she broke open the jar and poured the ointment on his head. But some were there who said to one another in anger,
"Why was the ointment wasted in this way? For this ointment could have been sold for more than 300 denarii and the money given to the poor."
And they scolded her. But Jesus said,
"Let her alone. Why do you trouble her? She has performed a good service for me. For you always have the poor with you, and you can show them kindness to them whenever you wish, but you will not always have me. She has done what she could. She has anointed my body beforehand for its burial. Truly, I tell you, wherever the good news is proclaimed in the whole world, what she has done will be told in remembrance of her."
Then Judas Iscariot, who was one of the 12, went to the chief priests in order to betray him to them. When they heard it, they were greatly pleased, and promised to give him money. So he began to look for an opportunity to betray him. On the first day of unleavened bread, when the Passover lamb is sacrificed, his disciples said to him, so he sent two of his disciples, saying to them,
go into the city, and a man carrying a jar of water will meet you. Follow him, and wherever he enters, say to the owner of the house, the teacher asks, where is my guest room, where I may eat the Passover with my disciples? He will show you a large room upstairs, furnished and ready. Make preparations for us there.
So the disciples set out and went to the city and found everything as he had told them. And they prepared the Passover meal. When it was evening, he came with the 12. And when they had taken their places and were eating, Jesus said,
truly I tell you, one of you will betray me, one who is eating with me.
They began to be distressed and say to him one after another,
surely.
He said to them,
it is one of the 12, one who is dipping bread into the bowl with me. For the Son of Man goes as is written of him, but woe to the one by whom the Son of Man is betrayed. It would have been better for that one not to have been born.
While they were eating, he took a loaf of bread, and after blessing it, he broke it, gave it to them, and said,
take, this is my body.
Then he took a cup, and after giving thanks, he gave it to them, and all of them drank from it. He said to them,
this is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many. Truly I tell you, I will never again drink of the fruit of the vine until that day when I drink it new in the kingdom of God.
Sustained by God's abundant mercy, let us pray for the church, the world, and all of creation. Blessed One, today the church sings glad hosannas as we enter Holy Week. Prepare us to bear witness to Christ's suffering and death endured for our sake. Gather your people around the cross and comfort us with resurrection hope. Merciful God, receive our prayer. Lord of life, renew your good creation and protect the balance of life on earth. Encourage the work of foresters, scientists, arborists, gardeners, and river keepers. Preserve the health of pollinating insects, songbirds, and native plants. Merciful God, receive our prayer. Lord of all, your Son triumphantly entered into Jerusalem. Establish your peace and justice among the nations today, especially in the Holy Land and in Sudan. Hold to account any with authority to judge others. Grant that courts, legislatures, and local governments will serve with integrity and compassion. Merciful God, receive our prayer. God of tender mercy, bring hope to any who feel forgotten or forsaken. Make a way for refugees and asylum seekers. Reunite families enduring separation. Make your love known to any who are incarcerated, institutionalized, or in foster care. Bring your healing touch to all who are sick, suffering, or in pain, especially Linda, Ken, Karen, Mary, Brent, and Dawn. Merciful God, receive our prayer. God who leads us into new life, guide us through this most sacred week of the year. Give energy and joy to our worship leaders, musicians, and pastors. Watch over those who travel and are on spring break. Merciful God, receive our prayer. Blessed One, our times are in your hands. Sustain us in discipleship throughout our lives and receive us into everlasting life. Thank you for the lives and witness of all who have passed on to eternal life, including Oscar Romero, Bishop and Martyr, Don, Bill, Ewa, and Larry. Merciful God, receive our prayer. We lift our prayers to you, O God, trusting in your steadfast love and your promise to renew your whole creation through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. May the peace of the Lord be with you always.
Let us pray. We raise our palms to Jesus, shouting praises to our humble King. Hosanna to the Son of David, God of good gifts. Receive these and all our gifts as we present them in faithful service for the sake of your gospel. Prepare our hearts to receive you in this meal as you pour out your very presence to Christ Jesus, the wellspring of eternal life.
Blessed are you, O God of the universe. Your mercy is everlasting, and your faithfulness endures from age to age. Praise to you for creating the heavens and the earth. Praise to you for saving the earth from the waters of the flood. Praise to you for bringing the Israelites safely through the sea. Praise to you for leading your people through the wilderness to the land of milk and honey. Praise to you for the words and deeds of Jesus, your anointed one. Praise to you for the death and resurrection of Christ. Praise to you for your Spirit poured out on all the nations. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, and broke it, and gave it for all to eat, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, and he gave thanks, and he gave it for all to drink, saying, "Take and drink. This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." With this bread and cup, we remember our Lord's Passover from death to life. O God of resurrection and new life, pour out your Holy Spirit on us and on these gifts of bread and wine. Bless this feast, grace our table with your presence. Reveal yourself to us in the breaking of bread. Raise us up as the body of Christ for the world. Breathe new life into us. Send us forth, burning with justice, peace, and love. With Thomas Cranmer, Jonathan Edwards, and Oscar Romero, your holy ones of all times and places, with the earth and all its creatures, with the sun and moon and stars, we praise you, O God, blessed and holy Trinity, now and forever. Amen. Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Jesus said, "Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled." Taste and see that the Lord is good. Jesus draws the whole world to himself. Come to this meal and be fed.
May the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in God's love and grace. Amen.
Let us pray. The meal you have chosen for your feast is a humble meal. O Christ, even as the animal who rode into Jerusalem was a humble beast of burden, accept our humble praise and our joyous shouts of hopeful celebration. Hosanna to you, the Son of David. We hail you as our King.
When they had sung the hymn, they went out to the Mount of Olives, and Jesus said to them,
"You will all become deserters, for it is written, 'I will strike the shepherd, and the sheep will be scattered.' But after I am raised up, I will go before you to Galilee."
Peter said to him,
"Even though all become deserters, I will not."
Jesus said to him,
"Truly I tell you, this day, this very night, before the cock crows twice, you will deny me three times."
But he said vehemently,
"Even though I must die with you, I will not deny you."
And all of them said the same. They went to a place called Gethsemane. And he said to his disciples,
"Sit here while I pray."
He took with him Peter and James and John and began to be distressed and agitated. And he said to them,
"I am deeply grieved, even to death. Remain here and keep awake."
And going a little farther, he threw himself on the ground and prayed that if it were possible, the hour might pass from him. He said,
"Abba, Father, for you all things are possible. Remove this cup from me, yet not what I want, but what you want."
He came and found them sleeping, and he said to Peter,
"Simon, are you asleep? Could you not keep awake 1 hour? Keep awake and pray that you may not come to the time of trial. The spirit indeed is willing, but the flesh is weak."
And again he went away and prayed, saying the same words. And once more he came and found them sleeping, for their eyes were very heavy, and they did not know what to say to him. He came a third time and said to them,
"Are you still sleeping and taking your rest? Enough. The time has come. The Son of Man is betrayed into the hands of sinners. Get up, let us be going. See, my betrayer has arrived."
Immediately, while he was still speaking, Judas, one of the 12, arrived. And with him there was a crowd with swords and clubs from the chief priests, the scribes, and the elders. Now the betrayer had given them a sign, saying, "The one I will kiss is the man. Arrest him and lead him away under guard." So when he came, he went up to him at once and said, "Rabbi," and kissed him. Then they laid hands on him and arrested him. But one of those who stood near drew his sword and struck the slave of the high priest, cutting off his ear. Then Jesus said to them,
"Have you come out with swords and clubs to arrest me, as though I were a bandit? Day after day I was with you in the temple teaching, and you did not arrest me. But let the scriptures be fulfilled."
all of them deserted him and fled. They took Jesus to the high priest, and all the chief priests, the elders, and the scribes were assembled. Peter had followed him at a distance, right into the courtyard of the high priest, and he was sitting with the guards, warming himself at the fire. Now the chief priests and the whole council were looking for testimony against Jesus to put him to death. But they found none. For many gave false testimony against him, and their testimony did not agree. One stood up and gave false testimony against him, saying,
"We heard him say, 'I will destroy this temple that is made with hands, and in 3 days I will build another, not made with hands.'"
But even on this point, their testimony did not agree. Men, the high priest stood up before them and asked Jesus,
"Have you no answer? What is it that they testify against you?"
But he was silent and did not answer. Again, the high priest asked him,
"Are you the Messiah, the Son of the Blessed One?"
Jesus said,
"I am, and you will see the Son of Man seated at the right hand of the power and coming with the clouds of heaven."
Then the high priest tore his clothes and said,
"Why do we still need witnesses? You have heard his blasphemy. What is your decision?"
All of them condemned him as deserving death. Some began to spit on him, to blindfold him, and to strike him, saying to him, "Prophesy." The guards also took him over and beat him. While Peter was below in the courtyard, one of the servant girls of the high priest came by. When she saw Peter warming himself, she stared at him and said,
"You also Jesus."
But he denied it, saying,
"I do not know or understand what you are talking about."
And he went out into the forecourt. Then the cock crowed, and the servant girl, on seeing him, began again to say to the bystanders,
"This man is one of them."
But again he denied it, Then after a little while, the bystanders again said to Peter, but he began to curse, and he swore an oath.
I do not know this man you are talking about.
At that moment, the cock crowed for the second time. Then Peter remembered that Jesus had said to him, before the cock crows twice, you will deny me three times. And he broke down and wept. As soon as it was morning, the chief priests held a consultation with the elders and scribes and the whole council. They bound Jesus, led him away, and handed him over to Pilate. Pilate asked him,
"Are you the king of the Jews?"
He answered him,
"You say so."
Then the chief priests accused him of many things. Pilate asked him again,
"Have you no answer? See how many charges they bring against you."
But Jesus made no further reply, so that Pilate was amazed. Now at the festival, he used to release a prisoner for them, anyone for whom they asked. Now a man called Barabbas was in prison with the rebels who had committed murder during the insurrection. So the crowd came and began to ask Pilate to do for them according to his custom. Then he answered them,
"Do you want me to release for you the king of the Jews?"
For he realized that it was out of jealousy that the chief priests had handed him over. But the chief priests stirred up the crowd to have him release Barabbas for them instead. Pilate spoke to them again,
"Then what do you wish me to do with the man you call the king of the Jews?"
They shouted back,
"Crucify him."
Pilate asked them,
"Why? What evil has he done?"
But they shouted all the more,
"Crucify him."
So Pilate, wishing to satisfy the crowd, released Barabbas for them. And after flogging Jesus, he handed him over to be crucified. Then the soldiers led him into the courtyard of the palace, that is, the governor's headquarters. And they called together the whole cohort. And they clothed him in a scarlet cloak, and after twisting some thorns into a crown, they put it on him, and they began saluting him.
"Hail, King of the Jews."
They struck his head with a reed, spat upon him, and knelt down in homage to him. After mocking him, they stripped him of the purple cloak, and put his own clothes on him. Then they led him out to crucify him. They compelled a passerby who was coming in from the country to carry his cross. It was Simon of Cyrene, the father of Alexander and Rufus. Then they brought Jesus to the place called Golgotha, which means the place of a skull. And they offered him wine mixed with myrrh, but he did not take it. And they crucified him and divided his clothes among them, casting lots to decide what each should take. It was 9 o'clock in the morning when they crucified him. The inscription of the charge against him read, "The King of the Jews." And with him they crucified two bandits, one on his right and one on his left. Those who passed by derided him, shaking their heads and saying,
"Aha, you who would destroy the temple and build it in 3 days, save yourself and come down from the cross."
In the same way, the chief priests, along with the scribes, were also mocking him among themselves and saying,
"He saved others. He cannot save himself. Messiah, the King of Israel, come down from the cross now, so that we may see and believe."
Those who were crucified with him also taunted him. When it was noon, darkness came over the whole land until 3 p.m. At 3 o'clock, Jesus cried out with a loud voice,
"Eloi, Eloi, lema sabachthani,"
which means, my God, why have you forsaken me?" When some of the bystanders heard it, they said,
"Listen, he is calling for Elijah."
And someone ran, filled with a sponge with sour wine, put it on a stick, and gave it to him to drink, saying,
"Wait, let us see whether Elijah will come to take."
Then Jesus gave a loud cry and breathed his last. And the curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. Now when the centurion who stood facing him saw that in this way he breathed his last, he said,
"Truly this man was God's son."
There were also women looking on from a distance. Among them were Mary Magdalene, and Mary, the mother of James, the younger, and of Joseph and Salome. These used to follow him and provided for him when he was in Galilee. And there were many other women who had come up with him to Jerusalem. When evening had come, and since it was the day of preparation, that is, the day before the Sabbath, Joseph of Arimathea, a respected member of the council, who was also himself waiting expectantly for the kingdom of God, went boldly to Pilate and asked for the body of Jesus. Then Pilate wondered if he were already dead, and summoning the centurion, he asked him whether he had been dead for some time. When he learned from the centurion that he was dead, he granted the body to Joseph. Then Joseph bought a linen cloth and, taking down the body, wrapped it in the linen cloth and laid it in a tomb that had been hewn out of rock. He then rolled a stone against the door of the tomb. Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of Joseph, saw where the body was laid.
The Passion Story of our Lord.
Be to God.
May the blessings of God the Creator, Jesus our Savior, and the Holy Spirit our Advocate be upon us and remain with us this week and always. Amen.